Hello everyone, my name is Mahima Kedia and I'm a qualified actuary from Institute and Faculty of Actuaries UK. In this video, I will be introducing one of my favorite actuarial subjects, CP3. Here is the broad agenda. I will start by giving a subject overview, which will give you an idea of what is expected in studying for CP3. We will then look at the syllabus prescribed by the Institute and details of each segment. Then I'm going to be talking about the structure of the exam, cost of registration, pass percentages, etc. I've also listed down a few do's and don'ts from my own experience, which I will be covering in the video. In the end, I will talk about how we've planned to prepare the students for a successful CP3 attempt. So let's get started. The name of the subject, CP3, is communication, and I'm sure a lot of you may have heard, at least I have, that actuaries cannot communicate as efficiently as they do technical analysis. In fact, it's a common industry preconceived notion that technical professionals who deal with huge data and numbers are not naturally good in communication. This is exactly what the paper is trying to address. As the name suggests, the objective is to learn how to communicate technical ideas to a non-technical audience. In other words, how will you explain an actuarial concept to a layman? Now, this sounds quite easy, and there are many myths surrounding the paper that I've heard, most common of which is that CP3 is a lottery paper, which means passing and failing of the exam is very subjective to the examiner. Let me tell you, this is not entirely true. There's a defined marking scheme in place, and it is strictly followed by the examiners. In fact, it is available for the students to prepare from. Now, usually students underestimate the time needed for preparation because we have all studied how to write reports, letters, emails in our high school, and who does not know how to communicate, right? But there's one common thing between all the people who are not able to clear this paper in first attempt is that they've not given enough time for preparation. In fact, IFOA suggests around 50 to 60 hours of preparation. Which brings me to the next point, that people don't know what to prepare for. And there are a number of resources available in ACT-ED. Unlike other subjects, core material is relatively small and there is not much to learn or by heart from the core reading. But the key is to practice past papers, or get it reviewed by your mentor, take constructive criticism positively and build from it. Having said all of this, CP3 is one of my favorite actuarial papers because it is such a beautifully written paper and it gives a good relief from all the other technical papers. I'm sure people who are planning to appear for this paper in April diet or in September diet would have given some or the other technical paper, maybe CS1 or any ST or SA papers. And this will be a very good break from all the other technical papers. In fact, you can club this paper with any other paper and it will break the monotony while preparing. And needless to say that the skill sets learned during the preparation of this paper will really help you in your career. It has really helped me on my corporate job because communication skills is what you will require throughout your career, whether you are an independent actuary or you're working for a corporate. You will need to be interacting with a number of stakeholders, and this will definitely help you. I hope I've given a fair idea about what the subject stands for. From here, we'll be moving on to the syllabus of the paper, which is prescribed by the Institute. Core reading comprises of 7 chapters, which is divided into 5 broader topics. Let's go through them one by one. First is to identify relevant information and appropriate content. This section teaches you how to identify key points which needs to be included in your piece of communication and certain information which is irrelevant and unnecessary and might just confuse your recipient. It also includes how you can present your numerical information in an appropriate format and with an appropriate level of details so that it is understandable to the recipient. You will also learn how to justify your choice of information and content. Second topic is to use an effective structure. The choice of your structure will depend on who you are writing to, who your recipient is. So this particular segment teaches you which structure to adopt in case your recipient is, say, a higher management or a top management versus if it's a policyholder or your colleague or someone from another department. Third point is adopt appropriate language. Co-reading suggests that the language should be very clear and understandable. The choice of your terminology is very important. It must not include any heavy technical terms which will not be understandable to your recipient. So this section will tell you best practices of what language you should adopt when speaking with different stakeholders. Fourth is include appropriate explanation. Now, this will form the major body of your piece of communication. So, this section tells you the level of details you should be including when you are explaining a point or when you are explaining an actuarial concept to a recipient. You must not put anything which is technically incorrect and is misleading to the recipient. So, and many more. So, this section includes the overall content or the overall body of your piece of communication. The last point is incorporate effective communication tools. We have a lot of options in choosing what tools you want to use when you're presenting a piece of numerical information or a subjective information. This section will help you to understand if you must use a bar diagram or a line chart when you are presenting a specific information. And there are other topics like how many bullet points you should be including and what is the justification of using one specific diagram or a picture when you are presenting a numerical information. So this is it about the syllabus. Let's move on to the next slide. Now I will talk about the structure of the exam. It is a single seating, 3-hour computer-based exam, which means you will have to type your answer in a Microsoft Word and upload it in their portal. Now, usually a few days before the exam, around 72 hours, you will be provided with an advanced piece of information, which will include description of the scenario within which your main exam question will be set. It can be understandable as the environment that you will need to be operating from while you are writing your answer. Now the objective of the exam or the exam paper will be to communicate facts from the pre-read and the main exam paper and not add to your knowledge, from your existing knowledge or insights of any other actuarial paper. Please keep this in mind. This is very important. Now, the main exam paper is divided into two parts. The first one is the main written piece of communication which you will be asked to write. It can be a report, a letter, an email, or anything else. You will have to answer that in and around 800 to 900 words. It will be followed by a set of reflective questions, which will basically test your thought process when drafting your first answer. The weightage between both the answers, both the questions is 80-20%, but do not underestimate the second set of reflective questions. It's very scoring, and this usually decides if you pass or fail the exam, speaking with experience. Let's now talk about the cost of registration. If you are planning to appear for the paper from Institute and Actuaries of India, you will need to pay around 11,000 INR. And if you are planning to appear for the paper from Institute and Faculty of Actuaries UK, and you have a reduced rate membership, you will need to pay 18,000 INR. Otherwise, it will be 33,000 INR. Let's talk about one of the most common questions I get. what is the pass percentage on the paper? So it is on an average 45%. But over the last few years, this pass percentage has been increasing to around 50 to 56%. So it's not that bad, right? Let's look at the structure of the exam now. It is a single seating 3-hour computer-based paper wherein you will have to type your answer in Microsoft Word and upload it in their portal. The exam paper is divided into two parts. The first one is a written piece of communication where you will be asked to write a report or an email or a letter to a specified audience who can be the CEO, CFO of your company or another department, a policy holder or any of your clients. You will need to answer that question in around 800 to 900 words. This will be followed by a set of reflective questions which tests your thought process when you are drafting your first answer. The weightage between both the parts is 80-20, but do not underestimate the latter reflective questions as those are really scoring and sometimes define if you will pass or fail the exam. The second point is that you will be given a pre-read, usually 72 hours before the exam, which will set a background and it will include a description of the scenario within which your main exam question will be set. You can consider it to be an environment within which you will have to be operating while you are writing your exam. Now, you are given these advanced set of information so that you only communicate facts from these exam paper and the pre-read and do not add from your pool of knowledge or insights from any other paper. We'll now look at the cost of registration of the paper. If you're planning to appear for the exam from Indian Institute, you will have to pay 11,000 INR. If you're planning to appear for the paper from Institute and Faculty of Actuaries, UK, and you have a reduced rate membership, then you will need to pay 18,000 INR, otherwise it is 33,000 INR. Moving on to one of the most popular questions I get, what is the pass percentage on the paper? And on an average, it is around 45%. But recently, over the years, this percentage has been increasing to around 50 to 56%. So that sounds quite promising, right? Moving on to a list of few do's and don'ts that I have listed down from my own experience of preparing for the paper. First is to practice creating graphs and data tables. Yes, it is very important for you to practice making graphs, be it in Excel or Microsoft Word beforehand, because while writing the exam, there is limited time and you don't want to spend that time trying to figure out how to format a graph or how to change numbers, etc. Also, while you are putting data tables or graphs in your piece of communication, be very careful with its choice. It should be very simple and easy to look at. It should not be complicated and messy for the audience. Second most important point is to avoid using jargons. Jargon is a complicated technical word which is understandable only to say your profession or people related to your profession. It may not be understandable to someone who is not associated with, say, actuarial science. An example of jargon would be correlation, regression. Sometimes even probability is considered to be a jargon. Use of jargon is penalized multiple times in the paper, it is very important for you to consciously avoid using any jargon. Third point is clearly lay a structure before proceeding to write answer. Try to create your simple story for this communication. Yes, once you're finished reading the question, take some time to not start jumping into typing answer. Take some time and lay a structure in your head. Create a story that you will be using to communicate. Having a good understanding on marking schedule as they are very segmented and try not to miss them in your mock. Yes, as I had mentioned before, there is a marking schedule in place and it is very strictly adhered upon by the examiners also. Please go through the marking scheme and practice your paper based on that. And also when if your mentor is reviewing it, please advise them to use marking schedule very strictly when they're reviewing your mock. One of the other important do's is review your answers at each stage in paragraph and ensure you're not repeating the message and your entire flow is in a logical order. You will obviously review your answer in the end before you submit. That is very important and needless to say. But if you get time, try to review your answer at each stage in paragraph so that in the end, it's not a lot of hustle. And you do not change a lot of stuff in your final review, which is one of my do not points. Other do not points are, do not spend too much time thinking about it. Use a minimal description in plain English. So if you are come across any jargon, do not spend a lot of time thinking about it. Just write what it means in plain, simple English. Do not jump into your answer with your pre-scenario. Very important. Students usually tend to create pre-scenarios in their head with the pre-reads they are given 2-3 days before the exam. And if you have a pre-scenario in your head, it is very difficult to relate to what is actually being asked in the question paper and answer to that. Try not to score full marks as you may lose the balance. This is true for all the actuarial papers we've come across and not just specific to this paper. I hope this is helpful. Let's move on to the next and the last section, which is how we are planning to prepare the students for a successful CP3 exam. We will start with a 2 days live classroom session per week, and we will cover core reading. We will do a lot of practice in fragments, try to address those specific segments that we mentioned, that we saw in the syllabus. Then after finishing the core reading and the syllabus, we will move on to one classroom session per week where we can discuss any like the common crowd doubts and any other topic that you would want to cover. And then one interactive session per student per week. That interactive session will be a one-on-one mentor-mentee session where specific questions will be addressed and review of your mock papers or your practice papers will be discussed. Needless to mention, there will be multiple practice questions and mock papers with detailed review for each student. This brings me to the end of my video, and I would just like to say that learning to communicate effectively is a gradual process. So keep practicing, practice a lot. And all the best for your papers.